The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and good morning. Welcome to one and all you who are here present in the church, and others who are joining us online. Our hope is that we offer hospitality to anyone who comes into our community and shares in our call to know and love God, and to enjoy God forever. So at this time, we have a couple of notes about the order of service, and Herman will introduce those considerations.
So if you look at your bulletins, either here or online, a couple of things. The choir anthem listed on the second page actually will be the place where the solo that would have been at the end of the service would be. So we will have Power of Your Love there. Then if you look farther towards the end of the service, you will see the solo, and that's where Hem of Your Robe by the choir will be sung. Additionally, the closing song, it lists Rebecca Shrimpton as soloist, but actually Rebecca Shrimpton is the composer. The choir is the soloist. And then lastly, the hymns in the very back, the first hymn will be the hymn that is listed second, the Word of God Incarnate. So you can turn your bulletins upside down and you'll have it right.
Decisions and revisions in a moment will reverse, as T.S. Eliot said. Okay, well, so now you've got the playbill, you're ready to go. And will you join in singing our first hymn, O Word of God Incarnate? May we join together in the opening prayer printed in your bulletin. O God, our Creator, we have gathered in your holy presence. You set before us the ways of life and death. We have gathered in the presence of Jesus the Christ, who calls us to know the cost of discipleship that we may know its joy. We have gathered in the presence of the Holy Spirit, who sustains us in trial and rejoicing. As we walk through the 40 days of Lent, we reflect and recommit ourselves to follow the way, truth, and light of Christ. We are refreshed and encouraged by the grace of your forgiving mercy as we go forward. Still, we suffer with those who suffer, and pray for those who pray for peace, and for a world that shares an amazing planet with many challenges and many opportunities. Bless your church universal with its heavenly hopes and bountiful Holy Spirit. We pray in Christ's name, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. as we come to our time of prayer, just a few words, sort of preparation. The Bible reading appointed for today is set forth in the Ecumenical Common Lectionary. So the reading we will hear from the prophet Isaiah is being heard in worship all around the world, in Catholic and Protestant churches all over. And I like thinking that we have that profound connection. And as we think and pray about the war going on in Ukraine, we can remember that those people are praying there, in the monasteries, in the churches, in the schools, in the hospitals. What else to do but get on your knees and pray? I'd like to share an experience that I had. It was April 1986. I was involved in the Massachusetts Council of Churches, and we hosted a meeting for a delegation from the church in the Soviet Union. At dinner, I was seated next to a man from Chernobyl, which was then part of Russia, and he was active in the theater, and he spoke pretty good English, and we established really a warm rapport, and he was really an impressive person. He cared about the church. And as I recall, he got a call during dinner saying that the nuclear power plant in Chernobyl had had a disaster. You remember, the destruction was going to be horrendous. He told me his wife and his children were there in Chernobyl, and he was just thinking about them and totally worried about them. His face expressed his anguish, his terrible pain. I reflect on the hospitality of the church, where we can welcome fellow Christians from international faith communities and share with them the powerful gift of the Spirit and the love of Christ. Even in these past weeks, we've heard about Russian clergy on the scene and the United Church of Christ, along with other denominations, church organizations that have risen up hoping to help. And gosh, our ecumenical vigil, which Susie planned and so many participated on in this sanctuary, that was a mighty moment. We could pray and sing, "Let there be peace on earth," and even hear the Ukrainian national anthem sung by our Paul right here. Hospitality to Jewish, Catholic, Protestant, Episcopal members of congregations and clergy. It was wholehearted and it was strong. We're overwhelmed when we think of the millions of Ukrainians fleeing, 3 million I hear today, hoping to find a place of safety and hospitality in other countries. So stressful for them, their children, and for the other lands that find themselves swarmed by needy refugees. Hospitality can demand sacrifice, be stressful. And we have many global concerns to raise in prayer today. But also, we have many personal concerns here that you may share. And so I call on you now for any joys and concerns that you would like to lift up. Please help us hear your voice as you speak. Any joys and concerns, prayers? George, well, I knew you were going to say something.
Stuart Barnes, he's my oldest nephew also. He's had MS for about 40 years or more. And recently he's been reacting to the medication, now has pneumonia, and is in rather serious condition. But there's a joy. Annie Greenleaf, our friend, was taken to the hospital about 3 weeks or so ago. Emergency, and was taken care of to the extent she was able to go to rehab. Well, she was able to come home yesterday, so she is now home. And she has 24-hour care for the next 2 weeks. And in talking to Dick, I said, well, we'll say a prayer for Annie anyway. He, oh, no, no, you know, Dick. No, say a prayer for me. I'm the one that's going to be taking care of her and the caretaker. I'm the one that needs prayer, so he's a great guy. So prayers for the family.
Thank you so much. Others? Yes, Sue. Linda. Okay, thank you. Yes, Steve. I didn't get the name, Steve.
Stephen
the Crown. Good. Thank you. Okay. Well, we all have prayers too fragile for the spoken word. So this is a time to lift up those prayers. If you are at home, you may speak them or you may just hold them in your heart as we take a moment for silent prayer here. Let us be together in prayer. Holy and living God, hear our prayer of gratitude for your church, given to many communities in the world. We thank you that Christianity first came to Russia in the holy city of Kiev in the year 988. We ask your blessing on all who are touched by the presence of the risen Christ and the Holy Spirit. We ask your blessing on all caregivers in the medical community doing research and providing health and healing knowledge. We pray for those who care for family members and friends and neighbors. We ask your blessing on all who grieve, for those who have died in the pandemic and in the war abroad, especially. We ask your blessing on teachers, all who look after children, those who work with the elderly or disabled, on all who take leadership in our communities and govern or seek to govern, all who serve in churches and who train student ministers to serve in Christ's name. Bless our staff here. We pray for our minister, Mark, as he takes time away this week, for Nancy, our executive secretary, for Jean, our Christian educator, for Herman, our music director, and Rebecca and Paul, who lead our music. We also pray for deacons, trustees, leaders of service and outreach through missions, and all who find a home in this congregation and offer hospitality here to others. In the 40 days of Lent, we especially reflect on our failure to follow the Holy Way,
Forgive us, O God, for what we have done and what we have left undone. We join in the global sense of penitence for harm to the planet's environment. We did not know what we were doing. Help us to know that you support us with mercy and grace that offers a new start, a new beginning. O God, your ways are not our ways. And we confess that we often do not see the way you would choose for us. But we trust that your wisdom will prevail. Bless us with a taste of the peace and joy your prophets and saints have told about. And bless each one of us as we walk the walk and come together to worship along the way. We pray in the strong name of Christ. Amen. Thank you.
This morning's Hebrew scripture comes from the 55th chapter of the book of Isaiah, one of the oldest of the what we sometimes call the Old Testament scriptures. As you can see, it's poetry as you read it in your Bible or in your church bulletin. These Old Testament poets were writing for music, so this poem is really intended as lyrics to a song. Hebrew poetry is structured a little differently than our classical English poetry, where we have rhythms, ta-ta, 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 and then a rhyme at the end of the line that matches the rhyme of the next line below it, or four or five lines down. It's very much like a Shakespeare sonnet. And yet, in the Hebrew structure of language, the first line states a thought, a point of view, or a message, and the second line repeats it a little bit differently. There's no attempt to make rhymes and rhythms in that sense. So we know that when we translate from a foreign language into English, we sometimes lose the music of the original, whatever the lyricism is in that particular language. However, I think that this New Revised Standard Version translation has captured that some of that music. And we will hear some of it at the in our closing benedictory response today that the choir will be singing. Tucked away into these verses, you may hear a familiar quotation that you've heard in a sermon or in Sunday school lesson. Here now, the 55th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? And you listen carefully and eat what is good. Delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant. My steadfast love for David, see, I made him a witness for the peoples, a reader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that know you not shall run to you because of the Lord our God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord that he may have mercy upon them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you, you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign, and it shall not be cut off. Thus ends chapter 55 of Isaiah.
Amen. That was marvelous to hear. And we listen now to some familiar words also from the last words of Jesus in his final speech according to the Gospel of John. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Well, this is a sermon preached on Isaiah 55 by our church building here. This building is going to preach the sermon. So you can notice the symbols and reminders placed right here and review them whenever you visit this sanctuary. First, a reminder of the presence of the risen Christ. You will see the empty cross suspended in the place of honor. And as you may or may not remember, every Sunday is a little Easter. So Lent is made up of 40 days plus 7 Sundays, which celebrate the resurrection. Every Sunday, you can count them in your calendar. 40 days plus 7 Sundays. We speak of the 40 days of Lent, but that doesn't include the 7 Sundays. Today, the presence of the congregation is about the body of Christ gathered here in worship. You can look at the empty cross and think about the risen Christ alive among us. And the sweet, sweet Holy Spirit is alive among us, and the pair of candles, which Paul Gadonis lit this morning, they are a symbol of the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we light them at the beginning of worship and extinguish them at the end. And the Holy Spirit was breathing in Jesus and the early church, and we say, shh, as we talk and relate, it breathes in our congregation even today. We're reminded the fruits of the Holy Spirit are love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Good spiritual gifts that we value in our congregation. But now, there is the flowers. Yellow and blue, of course, for Ukraine, but that reminds us that spring comes tomorrow. So those are spring symbols right there. But the symbol of see on your computer screen at home, and it's actually not too easy to make out from the pews, but see what it is. It is a pineapple. Of course, the pineapple is a symbol of hospitality, and hospitality is what sounds out loud and clear in Isaiah's proclamation. Isaiah says, you are welcome. Come, be part of the spiritual community who eats and drinks and prays and sings together. Hospitality is the core of the church's mission universally. Well, look up at that pineapple there. Kind of, how did that unusual fruit get to be such a strong symbol? In the 15th century, explorers, including Christopher Columbus, brought pineapples back to Europe, where they were much desired and very expensive. They remained a symbol of wealth in the 17th century, and George Washington said, no food pleases my taste like the pineapple. And Charles, King Charles II of England, he posed for his official portrait with a pineapple. One pineapple could cost as much as $8,000 in that day. They would be served to the most honored guests. And towns and inns and even individual households would display pictures or carvings of the fruit to convey a sense of welcoming. You often see pineapples in architecture of historic buildings, and so we see it in our own church, as in other churches, a high symbol of hospitality. So that symbol is placed high above us here in our church, almost too high to see. Hospitality naturally involves food. Isaiah says, eat what is good, let your soul delight itself in abundance. Let your soul delight itself in abundance. And we've got it right here, table spread out for us in the front of the church. We're going to have our coffee hour in a little while after worship. It's free, as Isaiah says. You don't have to buy it. It's provided and offered and laid out here to bring us together for some nourishment and also chance to mingle and converse together. This is hospitality. We do have water here for all who thirst, as Isaiah says, and it's such a welcome gift. And being a biblical theme, water represents more than just liquid H2O. Isaiah is probably speaking to Hebrew people who have been in Babylon and are on their way home over dry desert territory to get to Israel. So their thirst is big thirst. And the symbol of water in this invitation is all about abundant life. It's the water of life. It's the basic life-giving substance. Now, also in our church, in the very front here, which John Round helped me put there, is a baptismal font. Here we welcome new members into the body of Christ, the church. And we fill it with water for the ceremonial sacrament. And with all baptismal fonts, you can see it has eight sides. Why? You know, right? Of course, it represents the eighth day. It's the new creation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. New creation, the eighth day, eight sides. Sometimes whole buildings were octagonal. Ravenna is one. You can walk into the whole building and feel that you are being welcomed into the church with the sacrament of baptism. So, ho, 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 come to the waters. Isaiah speaks a refreshing message to the people of God who traverse the dry desert toward home. Quotation, as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven,
and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void. It shall not return to me empty. God's word is life-giving, full of hope. Another symbol is placed up here on our lectern. It's always there, ready for someone to read. We read it, we read from the Bible every Sunday. It forms the key to our whole worship. Sermons are based on passages of Scripture, which have been studied and reflected on by the pastor, the preacher. And sometimes people think it's a theme, but it's basically, what have we gotten out of this Bible, this precious holy book? In some churches, the Bible's placed right up on the altar. You've seen that, of course. It's a symbol of the whole story of our church. It's been our guide for almost 2,000 years. It's compiled of letters and poems. As Diane said, it's often very poetic, and there are stories, there are prophetic pronouncements. It's full of nourishment to our souls. So the hanging there during Lent, of course, it's violet in color. You don't know if it's Lent or Advent until you check your calendar, but it's purple, it's violet. It symbolizes sorrow and penitence. My stole also is violet, and that's, of course, you know what that is. That's a symbol of the towel that Jesus used to wash the disciples' feet. This is given at ordination to people in our tradition. And the robe, well, the robe, I'll just mention that this is an academic robe. That's a symbol of a learned ministry in the congregational tradition. So there you have some of the things around the word. Now, God's word has power and will be a covenant with God's people and will be a promise for their well-being and will be the message that comes true. I will be your God, and you will be my people. Our tradition does not believe that every word in the Bible is literal fact, but we trust that God's word can speak through the words in it. The wonderful Bible study sessions that Mark Boyer, our pastor, leads, make us realize how rich those words are with symbols and meanings, but not to be taken literally every time. We study it, we discuss it, we contemplate it, and put it right up in the front of our church for all to see. We listen for God's word with a capital W in the words of Scripture. And the response to its promise is exuberant, abundant joy. It overflows in singing. In The Sound of Music, we witness the von Trapp family escaping from Nazi dominance and climbing and trudging over the Alps and singing as they go. And the abbess from the monastery sings, "Climb every mountain," and she offers a blessing right there in the drama of The Sound of Music. She says, "You shall go out with joy and be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands." Such a powerful blessing. And she's quoting the prophet Isaiah we hear today. The abundant life can be marked by music. In this building, we sing our beloved hymns. We listen to the choir and soloists sing anthems. We feel joy. We feel hope. Our organ and piano are part of worship. We have trumpets on Easter. We have saxophones on Jazz Sunday. And we take up the melodies of the saints as we are moved by the music that praises God. Today, the choir is singing a benediction, lifting up these words from the prophet Isaiah. And our own Rebecca Shrimpton composed this amazing benediction response. So let your heart sing with us as we proclaim those words. And go out with joy, be led out with peace. Peace is like shalom. It's like being wrapped in total fullness of health and wholeness and peace. And may all who share in our worship in this building, and all who share in God's worship all over the world, be blessed. In Kiev, in Odessa, Lviv, Chernobyl, in Bucharest, Budapest, Berlin, Paris, London, Rome, Warsaw, and Moscow. Even in afflicted, troubled places, one can reflect peace and joy from trusting God and abundant hospitality from the universal church, the wider church we belong to. The hospitality of the church is worth singing about. And our final hymn was much loved by other churches I've known, and we're going to sing it together today. Of course, it sings about the Holy Spirit, which is the spirit of abundant hospitality and gracious feasting together, and singing in company with a cordial congregation who leaves this place with a sense of peace and deep joy. I said in the choir rehearsal, this is no cheap joy, but it is a deep joy. Rebecca's benediction response, based on the end of Isaiah 55, is impressive. And the choir will stay up here after the anthem and hymn and sing it. And may we all know the peace and joy of being a community of gracious and abundant hospitality. Amen. What happens next? Okay. Young choir sings. Okay. time to sing our closing hymn. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. It's printed on the bulletin.
Thank you.